So welcome to the Uncommon Talks.
Hi everyone, this is Uncommon Talks and today we have Swasti with us. So Swasti, why don't you tell something about yourself to tell the people who you are and what actually you do?
Hi everyone, I am Swasti, as Ankit has already introduced me. I'm a counseling psychologist. Currently I'm working in an NGO and I'm basically working on the field. I got into spirituality about 5-6 years ago, so I've been meditating regularly since then. And I think that that has helped me a lot in my professional career also. So I think like as a counseling psychologist, I'm doing all of these things and, you know, because I am into spirituality. So I think we're going to have a talk today on mental health and spirituality. Am I right, Ankit?
Yes, sure. And starting with the first question, if someone doesn't know about spirituality, for example, to a 12-year-old kid, how would you explain it?
Okay, Ankit, I would want to say here that for a 12-year-old kid, I wouldn't have to explain about spirituality to him or her, because I think that is so ingrained in them. I think younger children know more about spirituality than we do, because as we grow old, I think we get more and more into materialistic thing and, you know, we get away from what is really important. So I think like किसी 12 साल के बच्चे को बताने की इतनी जरूरत नहीं पड़ेगी, because that is in his nature.
Can you break this part?
Okay, so like if I have to explain in very simple terms, spirituality is something that gets you connected to what is real. You know, in these times, I think we are getting more and more involved with, you know, relationships, career, you know, getting more rich. And that is not the reality. That is not on which the world is built upon. You know, we get swayed away from what is real and we are more and more concerned about, you know, who becomes richer, how to earn more money. And that is how we get away from what is reality. The reality is us being connected with ourselves, us being connected with nature, us seeing world how it is, us, you know, knowing what is real. You know, being happy is being spiritual, I would say. You know, being in joy is, you know, spirituality.
Okay, but like when we have so many distractions in front of us, so how should we have the mindset to go back again into that natural elements, so that we can be ourselves and we can focus on the nature and the natural elements more?
I feel because there are so many distractions, with distractions comes a lot of problems. I think in our generation especially, like people are becoming sadder and you know, they're not
why is it happy happening? Like is it does it used to happen 10 or 15 years earlier also, or these things are happening more now?
They're happening more now because of the pandemic also, I would say. And also because we are getting away from where we should be, you know, what is more important to us. You know, there is like a thin line between spirituality and religiosity. Okay. And I have seen that more and more people are becoming atheist. More and more people are thinking that spirituality is basically you know, following one person or one ideal. And so they don't want to do it. They don't feel that that is cool enough. People are losing focus. People are becoming more and more concerned about career. They're becoming more ambitious. You know, earlier people used to be like, you know, itna kamaliya hai, and we are able to get that much, you know, we are able to give sufficient to our children, to ourselves, mm-hmm. and khana wagera khane ke liye hai, and that is enough. They were like satisfied with their lives. And you know, zyada I would say ki they were more connected with each other. You know, they gave more value to other people. You know, they gave more value to relationships. But now I think the way I see it, I don't know, maybe I'm wrong, but people are becoming more and more self-involved. In India especially, I think there used to be like a collectivistic culture, you know, ki families saath mein rehte the, and you know, they would give priority to living with each other in harmony. But now, you know, the individualistic culture is becoming more and more apparent. I think people are getting more and more self engrossed. I mean, which is important also. You need to give yourself priority, but that is causing so many more problems. That is causing, depression. That is making people feel lonely, and they're getting away from, that collectivism, I would say.
So I think this is true because there was a study, many people doesn't know about it, but it has been the longest study of around 80 to 90 years. And it was there in some institute in UK. So the study was focused on what all things bring happiness to people's life. So they tracked everything from the age of 15 to 80. And in the end, the number one thing was the relationships with people, your family, friends, your partner. That was the main source of happiness. And it was not money or fame. So I think it proves the point.
And the problem is that even after gaining all of that money and, even after getting in that position, people are still not feeling happy, They feel that, okay, I've done all this, what now?
Because if we see people giving up their lives, one can be because of financial reasons, we understand that. But the people who have enough, who have a funnel around them for their medical needs, food and everything, people are still committing suicide because of mental problems, because of relationships and all. So I think that proves the point that you're saying.
Right. Exactly. And I think abhi to zyada ho gaya hai ye, because there is no aim, previously, if I see for my mother or for my grandparents, they used to give a portion of their money to people in need. They used to do seva, and they used to have good companies where they would have kirtans and sing together or would have good conversations with each other. But now because of the pandemic also, and even before the pandemic, that has completely gone away.
And we have also seen that people are finding more validation. They are posting so many posts. They want attraction. They want attention. So is it natural to have these things, or is it not natural and not good for health? Because ultimately your happiness will depend upon other people's behavior or liking towards you.
If you see from the point of view of, living with the society, it becomes a little important because, this is the new thing that has come up. This is the new reality, because we are not able to meet with people because the pandemic is going on. We can't go out. There is no interaction. Imagine you're walking on the road and you put on the mask. Okay. So now other people cannot even see your expression. You're not even getting that sort of validation. People used to smile on the road when they used to see each other. Now that is not possible. They can't smile. They can't notice the expressions of other human beings. And as humans, we are a social animal. So we have come up with this other thing, this social media pad, And I think to some extent, those likes are similar to what I was telling you before, those smiles that you used to get when we used to walk on the road. I don't know if the comparison is right, but it sort of gives the same validation. Humans need to know that they are alive. And how do you know that you're alive? When people respond to you, when people see you and they smile, when people give you that validation, everybody needs validation. Some people are able to give that validation to themselves. Some people are not. And those people who are not able to give that validation to themselves, that is when, the social media, har ek minute mein post dalna, that becomes important for them. And I'm not saying that it's right or wrong. This is just an observation. I think it would be judgmental of me to say anything about people because I feel it's not in somebody's hand, Wo validation seek karna, nahi seek karna kisi ke haath mein nahi hai. Kyunki, imagine this, as you grow up, all of these seeking validation and the need to get noticed, that is ingrained as we're growing up because there are a lot of factors, environmental factors, how parents have raised us, all of these factors affect those, So, some parents have given that autonomy to a child so that they don't need validation when they grow up. But some parents have not. Or not just parents, the environment has not in general. So it really depends from person to person.
Makes sense.
It's different. So whatever floats your boat, I would say.
And the healing, the therapy that you do, so in what ways you help people? Like, what are the common things you observe that people have these sets of problems? And like, what are the patterns that you have observed?
Patterns I've observed. So yeah, one thing that I have observed is that not just in our generation, like people since forever have been craving for love, you know. And, you know, love is of different types.
Yeah.
But I feel they crave more and more for like their soulmate. I think the other day we were also talking. I mean, the concept of soulmate is so flawed. I feel like there is no soulmate, and that is going to break so many bubbles, but that is the truth. There is no one person, and people keep on seeking that one person throughout their lives. And when they're, the thing is, you are your own soulmate, you know, and we are raised to believe that there is someone out there who's going to like make you feel all good, make you feel better, give you everything that you've been seeking, you know.
Do you think that relationships of our generation, what are the common problems that we are facing? Jo I think pehle nahi hua karti thi.
I think aisa nahi hai ki relationship problems pehle nahi hua karti thi.
Things like money and all have become important now. So that those things are also causing, yeah.
Earlier, what used to happen was people used to have their aim, okay, their goals. Okay. And like they would have different goals and we would walk and parallelly, you know, throughout our life, we would walk parallelly and like strive for that one goal. But if you see for my grandparents, let's say my grandmother always wanted to, you know, become more self-actualized and as a person, she wanted to grow and, you know, socialize more. And my grandfather, his main goal was to, do more in career, and I don't want to be sexist here, but that was their goals, okay, that was their preference, that was what they wanted to do. But I think, and so they were walking parallelly and that worked for them. But if you see now, I see a lot of people wanting to go for similar goals. Now an engineer would want to marry an engineer, you know.
Okay.
So they would strive for same goal, and that is good for some people, you know, that helps them feel more connected and everything. But because there are no people don't have a lot to talk about, they feel that jitna same hoga person, you know, they would get along better, which is I think so flawed, because I feel ki you would have less and less to talk about. And see, I think like here again I am generalizing a bit. But this is one thing that I have noticed. Another thing that I've noticed is that people want to gain so many things from one partner, you know. Like if I am seeing a person, I would want that they should have like a similar taste in music. They should have, they should be into meditation, yoga, because I'm into it. They should, do well in career. They should also dance with me sometimes. So many things I'm expecting from that one person, you know, and sometimes that person is not there. And because I'm dependent on that one person for all of my needs, so basically I'm putting a lot of responsibility on that one person. And because
your
that is not
happiness, your satisfaction.
Yes. And because that is not fulfilled, then, you know, I feel bad that this person is not able to give me that. And then I'm going to have fights with that person. And I feel if I'm expecting so many things, you know, then I'm at fault here. You know, I should be able to give all those things to myself. I should be a complete human being in myself. And then maybe with someone I can share that joy, you know. And if something is not similar, then people tend to go for divorces. So people would not want to put in the work, you know, because of accessibility also. Because agar ye nahi to koi aur sahi, koi nahi to koi aur sahi. So I mean, like that way, people would keep on changing relationships, and it's good when you're like dating. So there is like, I feel there is a difference between dating and being in a relationship. Dating is, you know, when you're getting to know one person, you know all their flaws, you know what is there and what is not. And relationship is being committed with that one person, you know. And dating is good because you have choices and you see a lot of people. But when you come in a relationship, when you've already given that commitment, then you try and make it work.
When people go through a heartbreak, they get extreme emotions. So those emotions, though, are those are those emotions underrated or overrated? And the people who have shared your problem and the people that you have helped, what are the things that you think works best for them?
So it's different for different people, you know. I think it is very important to feel all those emotions. I would give you my example, okay. I went through a heartbreak, okay, like a year ago. And I was into spirituality. So I thought, you know what, this is not going to affect me at all. Because I'm spiritual, so I'm beyond all these things, and I am not going to feel sad because I know there are millions of people out there, and so I just like suppressed them a bit, you know. I did not want to feel all those feelings, so I made myself believe. I made myself believe that, you know, all of these things are not for me. I'm above these things. And after 2-3 months, I realized, oh shit, what has happened? Because those feelings I have to process, you know, you cannot suppress those feelings and expect you will move on from those feelings. Feeling your feelings is so, so important. And so I would say that not underrated or overrated, feelings are feelings. You cannot put logic on them. You know, if you're feeling something, you know, instead of getting scared of that feeling, you have to feel it completely. Even if, you know, that is lack of validation, that is feeling that nobody's going to love you, you know, that recurrent thought, you know, you have to feel it completely in order to overcome it. You know what I mean?
You mean to say is if the life is giving you pain in any kind, you have to show your sportsman spirit and you have to say, I can take it. Let's see how much more you can get.
So there are so many emotions, right? There is a family of emotions living in our head. If you've watched that movie Inside Out, okay. In that movie, let's forget about the movie, but what happens is there's a family of emotions living in our head, okay. And sometimes what we want to do is when we are sad or when we are angry, we want to like repress it, not feel those feelings. We feel that if we feel those feelings, we are going to feel bad. And nobody wants to feel bad, right? So we've given a negative connotations to some emotions and given positive connotations to some emotions. What we fail to understand is if we don't feel the negative emotions, we are not going to feel the positive emotions either. Ki agar tumne sad feel nahi kiya, to tumhe happy feel nahi hoga. Tumhe numb feel hoga. That is the feeling that you're going to feel. So if you don't process the emotions completely, you're going to become broken in a way.
I have a follow-up question on this also. So you think people know about themselves fully, or is it a lifelong learning experience? Like you keep discovering what all things you like, and how can spirituality accelerate or maybe act as a catalyst in that process?
I have a question for you for this. Do you think you're the same person you were 1 year ago?
No.
Do you think you will be the same person you are 1 year later?
No. But, so that means but I would, but the choices that we are making right now are for future. So it contradicts the whole concept that we're always changing. So how do we keep up with that? Because the person I'm right now, I'll invest in some things. And maybe after some years, I might not like it if I completely change myself. So is it a little complex, I think.
Do you feel you, like, jaisa tumhe ek saal pehle lagta tha, are you feeling like that now also? Like, there is a certain portion of you that feels that this is me.
Yeah, some things are same.
Some things are same. Like, there is a part of you that is you, okay? That is, that entity is completely you. That doesn't change. But what happens is because of environment, because of, you know, everything around
the
us.
People, we need the experiences.
As the experiences changes, So do we, unless we are not very flexible, we are rigid, then we won't change. But unless we want to get to that self-actualized stage, then that change will be, you know, constant. And that is a good thing, I would say. Because as time, for some people, it is a bad thing also though. I mean, like some people, as they get into relationships, they become more and more harsh. I mean, they stop believing in love. And I think like that changes them for worse, some experiences.
Yeah.
But coming out of those experiences and learning from those experiences, that is what, and processing those experiences completely and becoming aware of why things happened the way they did, you know,
understand.
Then you become a better person.
We can see the life in two broad ways. A person can see the life see, the ultimate thing is the truth that we know is that we all gonna die. You cannot change this fact. But a person A can live a life with a mission that I have to accomplish these things. I have to bring change in the society and I have to leave my legacy, you know, when the person dies. And another person thinks that ultimately we have to die. So what is the purpose of doing so many great things or working so hard and helping so many people? So what does spirituality says about these things?
I think what you're talking about here is karma. Like, are you trying to say that, like, you know, some people do good throughout their lives and then still, you know,
yeah, you can link it. You can link that question with this. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Something like that, you know?
Yeah.
So, what I think is that, in our generation, and I think like what general belief is that karma is anything good that we do, you know, what goes around comes around. And if we're doing good things to one person, then that good thing is going to come back to us, you know, like that. But I think that is completely flawed because you're only doing good because you're expecting something good to happen to yourself. You know, karma actually means any action whatsoever.
Okay.
You know, karma means, it doesn't mean just what you're doing. So like there are three types of karma. Okay. One karma is the seed of an action, like something you did in the past and that has robbed the seed. Okay. Then one action is that what you're doing right now. And then third action is what will happen later because of the action that you're doing now. Some people watch porn. Okay. So watching porn is an action that you're doing now. Okay. Why are you watching porn? You know, it has something to do from your past. Maybe your friends have had talked about it and said, oh my God, that is such a great thing to do. You should try it. Give it a shot. So that is why you're doing it. So that karma, when you had that talk, has robbed the seed of you watching porn now. And what is going to happen next because of this habit of watching porn? You know, you will feel the need or maybe you will do something later. You know, that has again put a seed for the future. So basically, karma is everything. Everything that is going around us is karma. Everything that is going to happen to us is karma. Whatever has happened to us is also karma. So some people say that, so there are positive types of karma, there are negative types of karma. Okay, so positive karma would be, you know, helping others or doing yoga and meditation, working out for your body. And so, you know, those are positive karmas. And negative karmas would be, you know, harming someone or saying mean things to someone else. So the general belief, what we have is that if we say something bad to others, then that is going to come to us. You know, somehow universe is going to build in a way that somebody else is going to say something bad to us, you know, but that is not how it goes. What happens is when you're saying something bad to others, it's not doing bad to that person. It is doing bad to you because somewhere that impression is stored in us, that is stored in our subconscious. So when you say something bad, it's not going to be like ki koi aake bura hi tumhe hi karega. But somehow the it's going to show in your future karma. So like a lot of people say that we should only hold on to good karma. That is again flawed. I would say that of course you need to get rid of bad karma. And how do you get rid of bad karma? Through meditation, through yoga, through pranayama. All of these things come into play now. Okay. So you get rid of bad karma through that. You also need to get rid of good karma because good karma also has its impressions. Let's say that you are washing your clothes, okay? And you get soap, okay? The soap is the good karma. You need that soap to get rid of the dirt, the bad karma. But in the end, you want to wash it and you know, you need to put water into it and get rid of the soap also. Why? Because soap is going to attract more and more dirt. It's not like you can leave the soap and everything will be good. So you need to become impressionless. You need to become hollow and empty. True. You need to become nothing.
And as a therapist, you said one thing that for a therapist, you all don't have a proper answer to any question. Like if someone is asking a problem, there is no correct, there is no right or wrong answer. So how would you explain it to the people?
For every person, the answer is different. You know, for some people, the answer is drug addiction. Now, here I'm not saying that getting addicted to drugs is the right thing. But for some people, if they don't consume drugs, they might get into self-harm or might, you know, kill someone. You know, that is their karma. That is how they have grown up. That is maybe in their genetics. You know, addiction is in the genetics, as you know. Oh, by the way, like karma is also in our genes. It is, it's not just our karma. Like what our action is not just our action. It's also for our future generations. You know, for example, if you don't exercise, if you eat a lot of unhealthy things, then your son might also have obesity or daughter might also become obese. So that can be passed down to your future generations also. So how can your son or daughter get out of that karma? By, you know, doing more good, by doing good karma. That is by getting into a workout schedule, by eating right. You know, so that is how you wash up that karma.
For example, I have alcohol addiction. Okay. And I came to you and I said that I need help. You need to counsel me that I should leave it. So how would you take this?
Here the thing is that you want to leave it.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not asking you that you have to leave it. I cannot ask you that because I don't know what are the circumstances. Imagine if I ask you to leave alcohol completely, you know, not even a sip. Will you do that?
No.
Exactly. So every decision is up to us. What's right for us, we know the best. A counselor or a psychologist cannot tell you what is correct for you. The other day, you know, there was a couples therapy going on, you know, and this person had cheated on the partner, you know. I can maybe place a judgment on that person. Be like, they cheated, so they are like a bad person. And I have made that judgment about that person. Ki ye to bure hai, so what is the point of this therapy? This is like a bad person. You should discard this person completely. But in the therapy setting, that sort of judgment is not going to help that person in any way. That is not going to help the therapist in any way, you know. So we keep the judgment. I think like a lot of people feel that therapists are the most judgmental people and they're going to judge us and they get scared that they are going to judge us. But I feel they're the least judgmental people.
Are the therapists.
You know, they don't judge at all because judgment doesn't get all them problems. Anywhere. Plus, same goes with decisions also. Yeah, exactly. And same goes for decisions also. I mean, like, if I tell somebody to do something, and I know that this might be good for them, maybe it is not good for them. Maybe it is good for a wider population, but not for them. I'll give you an example. A few months ago, I had gone to this village, okay? And this family, the girl in the family had got molested. Okay. So the father had put in an FIR against the perpetrator, and but the perpetrator's family was putting some pressure on them, and the village was against them putting that FIR. You know, the sarpanch and everything were like, you know, you should not do it because the reputation will be bad, and how about you let it be, let the FIR go. So you know, he was in a conundrum. Should he let the FIR go, or should he, you know, let it be and, you know, fight for his right, you know, be there for his daughter. And then he asked me, you know, what should I do? I don't know what is the right thing here to do. How can I tell him? Because whatever I know about the situation, I know from him, from his perspective. Whatever he has told me, there are only a limited things he has told me in 1 hour. I cannot know everything that there is to know, right? So I cannot make that decision for him. What I can do is maybe help him understand the pros and cons of his action. If he does decide to pursue the FIR, what are going to be the pros and cons for it? And if he decides to drop it, what is going to be the pro and con for that? You know, I can help him understand what is that, but I cannot tell him that this is the right thing to do. You do this.
So in a way,
that is not what a therapist.
If a person has to realize something that he's doing bad, it has to come from within. You cannot tell a person that this is wrong and they will understand that this is wrong. But because in the back of their mind, I think they already know this thing. you just have to explain them that what can be the consequences. You have to explain different situations, and through these things he or she might make up their minds. And recently you visited Rishikesh, and it was a very nice trip, and I used to see stories and all. So what are all the things that you learned from there which are related to spirituality, yoga, meditation, which people doesn't know, and what are the misconceptions which people have about meditation, yoga, and all these things?
First, I would love to talk about Rishikesh. I think I never get bored of talking about Rishikesh, because those were the best few months I've had in my entire life. I mean, I was there for 3 months, and I had taken up this yoga training course. So like, we used to have like a set routine for 1 month. So I used to wake up at 5 o'clock, and I used to do, we used to have like 2 hours of yoga. We used to do like Surya Namaskar. There are like different types of Surya Namaskar also. So we used to do that. Then we used to have like classes. We have like breakfast and then classes again for like philosophy, yoga philosophy. And then we used to have yoga anatomy. We used to have pranayama. All these classes used to go on for like 2 hours. And then lunch. And then in the evening, we would get free by 7. And then after that, I used to like have... so, you know, the concept of satsang. Now, when I use satsang with all of my friends, they would be like, oh, she's like a baba. Maybe she's going to... have like a bhajan
mandali coming together and singing songs.
We'd have like a dholak and we would like play that dhol and everybody would be dancing like crazy, like Mata ka Kirtan or something. But that is not what satsang is. Basically, sat means, if we break the word, sat means like good, and sang means company.
Okay.
So basically good company. So all these people, we used to like come together with similar mindsets. We used to have like debates, we used to sing songs, and we used to give those songs to like the universe. Like, these songs are for the universe. Sometimes we would sing songs from Bollywood movies, you know, and we would be like, this love is just for the universe. That was the idea of it. Or we would dance some
universe a lot. Why is it so?
Because that is the truth. I mean, what else is there? I mean, our mind gets so I think we've put our minds in a box, you know, we've a set path, a set goals that, you know, by 30, you need to get married, and by 35, you need to have a kid.
We limit our knowledge, our thinking, our experiences. I think
we have limit ourselves, limited. We have a limited mindset. So we limit ourselves, but that is not the truth. You know, that is what society has led us to believe. But the truth is so much bigger than that. And I feel like people go through so many problems, like one relationship breaks and we are like, this is the end of the world for me. But come on, see the bigger perspective. There is so much more than that one relationship. That relationship was there for your growth, you know?
And I think gratitude comes into place at this point, because we cry over so many things, relationships, mainly our relationships, a lot, our jobs and all. But we see at the other end, people are not getting food and water and shelter. Like, they're not getting basic needs. And we are so grateful than those people, because a dying person would need that. He wants to live. A person who hasn't eaten for 3 days, he would like, I can get food. So we have so many small problems that we forget about the things that we have.
But here, I think this is again like a flawed concept. I think, have you heard about the term toxic positivity?
So you are saying gratitude is a fraud concept. Practicing gratitude.
Yeah.
Why?
A little. So I'm not saying gratitude as a whole is a flawed concept. I am just saying that there is a thing called toxic positivity. You know, we tend to say this to other people, that if you're sad, look at a person who's more sad than you, and then you're going to feel happy about your sadness, that because you're not that sad, at least you're getting water and, you know, food to eat. But the thing is that your sadness is still there, you know, your sadness is still validated, even if some other person is more sad. Let's say, have you ever had like a fracture, or have you ever had like a stomach ache, or I'm asking you, like, have you ever had a fracture?
Yeah, 3 times.
Did you go to the hospital?
Yes.
Why? I mean, some people have cancer.
Because I'm not getting it.
You see, all I'm saying is that just because you had you didn't have cancer doesn't mean you didn't need to go to the hospital. Your fracture was still validated. It was still pain.
So you are saying even if we have small problems, we need to heal ourselves.
Yes.
Like, why do we need to have so many problems? Why do we need to get into that state if we can avoid it at the first place?
So basically you're saying that to avoid breakups, don't get into a relationship at all.
No. For example, if you had a breakup, right, then you can, instead of going into that mindset where you are sad for 1 year, 2 years, and you are not moving on and doing ridiculous things, you are getting into drugs and all. So why not use that energy to do something constructive?
But here, Ankit, I feel like some people are able to do it. They are able to use that energy, the breakup energy, I call it, to make their lives better and use that energy in something productive. And some people are not. I mean, it's not, I feel like instead of being judgmental, we need to be a little more sympathetic. I feel it's not in everybody's hands, you know. And that's completely all right. If you're feeling that sad, that sadness is completely justified. Just because some people are able to move on quickly doesn't mean that you cannot be sad, you know. Everybody is different. Everybody's ways of dealing with that sadness is different. Some people get into drugs. And I feel like whatever is your way, whatever is working for you, it's important for you. I mean, I did a lot of stupid things when I was young, okay? A lot of silly things. One time I went outside with my car at 4 o'clock and my mother and father were like super scared. Okay. But had I not done it, I would not know now not to do it, you know?
True.
So, I mean, like, you need to be stupid to be smart. You know what I mean?
You have to experience, you have to try different things. Even though you know
you need to accept yourself also that, you know, I did that with total awareness, and only with total awareness will that growth come.
Awareness is a very strong word when it comes to spirituality and meditation. Awareness is the most important word, I think.
Most important. Yeah. I think like one question that you'd ask, what are some myths about spirituality? Is one thing I would like to say is that sometimes we often feel that meditation means that somebody who's like sitting for 1 hour and closing their eyes and, you know, thinking about God. Mm-hmm. I think meditation is life. I mean, like there are millions of ways of meditating. When I was in Rishikesh, I learned that there were like, if you're walking and you're completely aware of that walk, if you're noticing the green, if you become that greenery, that is meditation. If you, if you're taking a shower, and you know, the water, you're completely aware of how the water is flowing. You're completely aware of how your thoughts are changing with the flow of water. That is meditation. If you're sitting in front of Ganga and you're looking at the water and you become that water, that is meditation. I mean, when I was having Coke, that is also meditation, because I was noticing how it is going inside of me.
So basically, you know? Meditation is all about being in the present and not thinking about the past or the future. And meditating is a state that doesn't need any technique, but reaching that stage requires practice.
Yes, absolutely. So I mean, like, you need to sit for that 1 hour because you are not there yet.
It is like training your mind.
Get yourself into
the meditative state.
Into everyday life, you know. That is a goal here. And I think purane zamane mein I had seen ki Rishi Muni would like sit and 50 years ki tapasya karte hain, and then agar koi bhi aake unki tapasya bhang kar deta hai, then they would like say that, okay, you will turn into a snake because you did that. They would be like so angry, right? I feel that was not meditation. Because they were not bringing it into life. I used to do that. Like whenever I would sit in my room and meditate, and if my mom would come and disturb me, I would snap at her.
So how did you start meditating? Focusing on your breath or some other technique?
I got into Art of Living. That was the first step into it.
Was it a good experience?
It was a very good experience. I'm still into it. But I would say that you should also be into other things. I mean, the more the merrier.
spirituality with you, but it is not like you have to be only in that thing.
ये चीज करने के लिए like you said कि experience होना चाहिए, right? You have to do something wrong to get into good. You have to be stupid before you get smart. Right? So I totally agree to that because वही मैं example से समझाना भी चाह रहा था उस वक्त. Because let's say मेरा friend है, जब मैंने podcast उसके साथ किया, so before that he was not into fitness at all, right? And he used to do drugs, he used to do substance abuse, all those things. But जब तक उसने वो नहीं करा, जब तक he didn't get bullied and in school or he didn't get ignored by the people and he didn't have many friends, so उसको जो importance है ना friendship का and relationship का, उसको वो चीज मालूम नहीं पड़ता maybe अगर वो उस चीज से go through नहीं करता, right? उसे ये नहीं पता चलता उसकी body पे क्या effect पड़ता है और उससे कितना कुछ बुरा हो सकता है उसके साथ. But he went through that and now he knows, he is more wise now इन चीजों को लेके, और इन चीजों को लेके वो दूसरों को भी guide कर सकता.
Exactly. You wouldn't be who you are if you hadn't done all the mistakes in the past. You're completely right. I agree.
And also that you said ki you have to be, meditation is all about awareness, right? Ki self-awareness hai, awareness about your surroundings. Surroundings mein kya chal raha hai? Agar main baitha hoon to main hawa feel kar raha hoon to kaise kar raha hoon, kahan kar raha hoon? Mujhe pata hai meri body kahan ho rahi hai. And let's say, I heard this in a speech by R. Madhavan, that actor. So he said he went to a that coaching or something, spiritual coaching somewhere in South. So usme bhi basically yahi tha ki they taught ki jab tum food ko chew kar rahe ho na, to us cheez ko dhyan se karo analyze ki tum kitni baar chew kar rahe ho, aur jab tak wo tumhare muh mein ekdam liquid form mein na aa jaye na, tab tak usko chew karte raho. First thing, digestion better hota hai. Second, tum apne khane pe focus kar rahe ho. Because these days हम क्या कर रहे हैं, हम friends देख रहे हैं, हम कोई movie देख रहे हैं, हम बातें कर रहे हैं खाना खाते time. And there is a Ankit should know this, that fitness related है. There is a mind and muscle connection. Also there is a connection between food and body. तो तुम जो खाते हो, अगर तुम उस पर ध्यान दोगे तो तुम्हें पता रहेगा, तुम्हारी body को पता रहेगा कि वो चीज कहाँ पर लगनी चाहिए. So I guess that is also a meditation.
Absolutely. I mean, like a lot of people, like I also, whenever I'm eating food, I would like just pray a little Annadatta Sukhim Bhava. Okay. And that is like a small prayer. It's just like three words ka prayer hai. Why I do it is not because ki haan, matlab mujhe aise rakhna chahiye ki haan yaar ye khana hai bhagwan se, wo pray kar lo, but this is a form of spirituality. Basically, I'm thanking everyone, every farmer, who has put in the efforts to provide me with that food, and because I am doing that, I will be eating that food with more gratitude.
Har cheez religion se isliye jodi jati hai taki hum easily samajh paye, aur koi bhi insaan, koi bhi layman, but actual mein hota kya hai, uske piche koi na koi logic hota hai. So when you pray, before you food, you are basically calming your mind, you are basically focusing on food itself. So usko gratitude de do. And basically before eating, you are focusing on the food, nothing else.
Also, like you said ki har ek cheez ka ek humne religion se isliye joda hai because it a normal human would follow it blindly, you know, and like usko fir question nahi karega to at least like wo action mein aata rahega. So for example, a lot of people had said ki ha matlab aapko ek particular side of bed pe apna sar rakh ke sona chahiye kyunki warna aapko shaitan le jayega, you know, there is a superstition. But what is the actual there is a scientific reason behind it, kyunki hamari earth ki magnetic waves kis tarike se hai us tarike se matlab hum usko karke dekhte hain. So and also like हमारे अगर मंदिर के अगर हम सीढ़ियां देखें, इट्स लाइक पर्टिकुलर हाइट की वो सीढ़ियां रहती है एंड दैट पर्टिकुलर हाइट इज बेसिकली वर्किंग ऑन द नर्व्स ऑफ आवर फीट एंड दैट इज कॉजिंग अस कामनेस. एंड इफ यू सी हमारे टेम्पल्स के अंदर बाहर भी लाइक यू वुड सी लाइक अ लॉट ऑफ स्कल्पचर्स जिसमें लाइक नेकेड कामा सूत्रा स्कल्पचर्स यू वुड सी. व्हाई इज दैट? It is because so that we can leave all those thoughts behind. It is not saying ki in thoughts ko aana hi nahi chahiye. It is basically saying ki haan accept kar lo in thoughts ko, even if it is coming. So there is like a scientific reason behind everything.
You should not sleep with your feet facing south.
Yeah, right.
So, it's because हेड तुम्हारा नॉर्थ में होना चाहिए, सॉरी हेड साउथ में होना चाहिए एंड फीट शुड बी इन द डायरेक्शन ऑफ नॉर्थ. उसका रीजन होता है कि मैग्नेटिक फील्ड्स का एग्जैक्टली, बिकॉज जो हमारा ब्लड का सर्कुलेशन होता है अदरवाइज वो अपोजिट डायरेक्शन में जाने लग जाएगा, उससे हमारे ब्रेन पे इफेक्ट पड़ सकता है. तो उसका वो मैग्नेटिक रीजन रहेगा.
राइट. So, हाँ, मतलब हमने काफी कोरिलेट किया. देयर इज लाइक अ थिन लाइन बिटवीन स्पिरिचुअलिटी एंड रिलीजियोसिटी एंड आई थिंक लेटली एथिज्म इज बिकमिंग अ रिलीजन आई वुड से, क्योंकि रिलीजियोसिटी को हमने कोरिलेट किया है विद देयर इज अ नेगेटिव कनोटेशन अटैच्ड टू इट. वी फील कि रिलीजियस है मतलब लाइक दे वुड बी अगेंस्ट अदर रिलीजन्स, यू नो, बट स्पिरिचुअलिटी इज मोर होलसम. इट इज पुटिंग एवरीथिंग अंडर वन अम्ब्रेला. So, yeah, I would definitely say that.
So, let's say if we are in office or somewhere else and we need some time to space out and focus ourselves. So, uske liye koi tip hai how to get in that meditation zone?
For different people, it is different. But I would give you like a small technique, which I think it's my favorite technique. It's called 5-4-3-2-1 technique. Okay. What you need to do is you see five things that are around you. Would you like to do it with me? Like, can you notice five things that are around you and then like tell me what are the five things that you're seeing? Only seeing.
Okay. See, my phone, speaker, laptop, my headphones, and a scale.
All right. Now, four things that you can touch. Touch those things of different textures. And then can tell me how it is feeling.
Wooden table. It is rough. The laptop, the finishing is smooth. Mm-hmm. And my chair, the leather feel. I don't know how to describe that. Yeah. And apart from that, the ball, dry.
Did you touch it?
Yeah.
All right. And now, three things that you can hear around you. What are three things that you are able to hear around you?
बाहर एक मजदूर लगा हुआ है, वो खटखट कर रहा
है.
मेरा चल रहा है. And that is it, I guess. दो ही चीज सुनाई दे रही है फिलहाल मुझे. Apart from your voice.
So my voice, so three things you're able to hear. And then two things that you are able to smell. Two things that you're able to smell. Those smells jo aa rahi hai, distinct smells. Agar smell nahi bhi aa rahi hai, to something, kisi ki smell agar pasand ho, imagine that smell and describe it to me.
Right.
Huh?
Well, imagine se kabhi kabar aa jata hai smell. You can actually, yeah. So first would be, there's a perfume, pool water, basically that.
Yeah.
And second is kulcha.
Kulcha, nice. And then one thing that you're able to taste.
Beer.
Beer. Okay. Yeah. Great. So basically, this is a technique. Right now, what we did was you didn't do it yourself. So maybe you were not able to focus on it completely. And because I'm also talking to you, maybe your focus was not completely on the technique. But what I'm trying to say is you can use all of your five senses to basically reshift your focus.
Okay.
This is a grounding technique. Grounding technique basically means how to ground yourself, how to, you know, not feel the way you are. Because often how we feel is basically connected with past and future. And sometimes we forget about the present moment. So to come back in the present moment, we can use our five senses to bring awareness to our surroundings, to ourselves. And that is how it helps. So this was a small technique. I hope it helps.
Yeah, sure. This will help our audience in some way, maybe.
Okay, not and you.
अभी तो नहीं, या फॉर श्योर अभी इतना अवेयरनेस ऐसे एकदम से नहीं आ सकता. अपार्ट फ्रॉम दैट आई डोंट नो, देयर आर लॉट ऑफ टेक्निक्स आई हैव हर्ड अबाउट. देयर इज ब्रेथ वर्क.
या दैट्स व्हाट जनरली दैट्स हाउ आई स्टार्टेड मेडिटेटिंग. आई यूज्ड टू डू सुदर्शन क्रिया एंड दैट बेसिकली यूजेस ब्रेथ वर्क. सो द आइडिया बिहाइंड इट इज, सो व्हेन यू आर एंग्री व्हाट सॉर्ट ऑफ अ ब्रेथ डू यू हैव?
फास्ट.
Fast. And when you're like, you know, calm, and when you're smelling like a flower, what sort of breath do you have? Right. Slow. So the idea is that because we know ki hamare jab emotions change hote hain, to hamari breath change ho jati hai. सो फ्रॉम दिस वी कैन डिसाइफर कि जब हमारे अगर हमारे ब्रेथ पे कंट्रोल आ जाए तो हमारे इमोशंस को भी हम चेंज कर सकते हैं. इट इज बेसिकली लाइक अ काइट, मतलब काइट का थ्रेड हमारे हाथ में है और काइट हवा में उड़ रही है, ठीक है. और हम अगर अपनी ब्रेथ इज द डोरी इज द ब्रेथ, ओके, अगर हम अपने ब्रेथ को कंट्रोल कर सकते हैं तो हमारे इमोशंस भी ऑटोमेटिकली कंट्रोल में आ सकते हैं. So yes, definitely you can do a lot of breath work and that is very, very, very helpful. I would suggest that. And that is what pranayam is. There are different types of pranayama. Har ek pranayam ka alag function hota hai. I learned that in Rishikesh, that also. Yeah.
So actually I saw this guy who is also called Iceman.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, ekdam North Pole pe rahega aur he can control his breathing and he can control his body temperature. And he also talked about and he also did some experiments on this breathwork only. Mm-hmm. So people in that breathwork, they breathe heavily, like bahut tez tez and bahut heavy.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's a sudden outburst of emotions. Do you know something about this? Why does that happen?
Okay, so there is a difference between like pranayama, like actual pranayama and meditation. And then there is self-hypnosis. So a lot of people who... do meditation think that they're doing meditation, but that is basically self-hypnosis. Okay, so there is a difference between it. I would like to give jaise wo Iceman ka example diya, that is so apt. You know, when I was in Rishikesh, I used to do a lot of experimenting. Okay, I used to experiment with a lot of things. I had time and that was my main aim to be there. So one day what I did was I meditated with temperature. So I was there in December में उधर का टेम्परेचर मतलब ऐसे 3 degrees कुछ होके रखा था, ठीक है. एंड गंगा बह रही थी, मेरे हॉस्टल मेरे होटल के पास में थी वो. सो आई डिसाइडेड दैट आई विल नॉट बी वेयरिंग अ स्वेटर, ओके, आई विल ओनली बी वेयरिंग लाइक अ स्मॉल लाइक अ टी शर्ट सॉर्ट ऑफ अ थिंग. एंड आई डिसाइडेड नॉट टू वेयर अ स्वेटर, ओके. एंड आई थॉट लाइक व्हाई नॉट ट्राई इट, लेट्स गिव इट अ शॉट. एंड आई डिड नॉट वेयर इट एंड आई वॉज वेरी अवेयर ऑफ where all the air was touching me. Not just the air, I also noticed my breathing. So there is this particular type of breathing called Ujjayi breathing. Okay, Ujjayi basically means victorious breathing. So that is what you do during yoga also. A lot of practices involve that. So what it does is ki wo oxygen ka level, jitna oxygen aapke normally lungs ke andar jata hai, usse zyada expand karke wo oxygen ko andar lekar jata hai. Basically, it... increases the capacity of you holding oxygen. And because oxygen, do you know how the oxygen originated? Basically, oxygen ka kaam tha burn karna. Oxygen and fire right. are associated. Okay. So, so oxygen gives you that fire wali thinking. Basically, oxygen ki wajah se hi hamari body decompose ho rahi hai. Actually though. So that is why the slower your breaths, the more you will live. That is a fact.
There are some antioxidant foods and fruits. वो तभी खाने पड़ते हैं तभी because oxygen की वजह से decompose होना start होता है. Oxidize basically oxidization जो process है वो हमारे body के cells पे भी होने लग जाता है.
Right.
Those kind of foods. And that guy I remember it is called his name is basically Wim Hof. Also called Iceman and a superhuman.
Yeah. So he's not superhuman. He's basically using science. You know, so when I did not wear sweater and when I went out and I was breathing in Ujjayi and I was sitting near Ganga and suddenly I felt an urge to maybe take a dip and I took a dip, you know, and it was 3 degrees and the water was so like cold, but I did not feel cold because I had made my mind believe that it was not cold. And because my breathing was that way, because my control was completely on my breath. So I did not feel cold and I came out and I did not wear a sweater for 3-4 days and I did not feel cold and I did not even get cold. Aisa bhi nahi tha ki mujhe main bimar ho gayi ya aisa kuch. So basically a lot is we don't know the capacity of us. We don't know what we are capable of. And I think like that increasing that is only possible through experimenting, by doing it yourself. When you do it yourself, that is why you will know that this is what you're capable of. Like breathing has so many advantages, but if you don't do it yourself, then you're not going to know what are the advantages of it.
But just a disclaimer, ki koi aur na kar le. She was practicing. Wim Hof also experimented with people. Scientists ne uspe experiment kiya, wo groups ke saath hota hai. He teaches them ki pehle breath work hota hai. Then he slowly get them adapted to the weather. ठीक है, उसके बाद take them to the river, वहाँ पे जाके उनको एक दो घंटा बैठना भी होता है river के अंदर, वैसे minus degree temperature, तब उनको breathing role आ जाता है और तब जाके वो कर पाते हैं.
हाँ, it's a slow process. I mean, I was there for 3 months and I was doing yoga regularly, firstly. Like, I was doing it for 4 hours every day. Okay, I was doing pranayam for 1 hour every day. I was meditating throughout. Like, पूरे time में meditation कर रही थी वहाँ पर जब मैं थी. Okay, so it's not like I did it like out of the blue key. You know, today I decided. I was intermittent fasting, you know. So, मेरा पूरा कंट्रोल था मेरे खाने पे, मतलब हर एक चीज पूरी कंट्रोल थी. दैट इज व्हेन आई वाज एबल टू डू इट. इट्स नॉट लाइक यू कैन जस्ट डू इट आउट ऑफ द ब्लू. यू हैव टू हैव दैट एक्सपेरिमेंट करने का भी एक पूरा प्रोसीजर होता है. यू फॉलो दैट प्रोसीजर एंड देन डेफिनेटली इट कैन हैपन.
इंटरमिटेंट फास्टिंग तो अच्छा होता है, 16 एंड 8 आवर्स.
राइट.
ट्राई किया है, मतलब एक महीना ट्राई किया था. इफेक्ट अच्छा होता है, बट हां मैनेज पाते जब डेली रूटीन में होते हैं.
हाँ, daily routine में you can't do it because you're not doing the rest of the things, you know. And intermittent fasting अच्छे से नहीं करो, then it can cause weakness. Otherwise, it gives you so much energy. It detoxifies everything. It is amazing.
No, so there are gurus who says कि you have to feel that hunger. क्योंकि हम हर time क्या होता है, हमें accessible है आजकल food. तो हम हर time खाते रहते हैं, तो हमें hunger feel नहीं होता है. हम अपनी body और brain को hunger feel करने का time ही नहीं देते.
थैंक यू सो मच. एंड आई थिंक लोग जो ये देखेंगे, बहुत सारे क्वेश्चन उनके आंसर हो जाएंगे. एंड इट वॉज अ वेरी गुड एक्सपीरियंस. एंड विल डू अनदर पॉडकास्ट किसी और टॉपिक पे कभी.
Definitely. I loved talking to you guys. I mean, I got to know so many things from you, and this is definitely helpful for me as a person to grow. You know, this is an experience.
And one thing, if you would like to say to people, jinko bhi they have some issues or something, and in a way you can help them, or what kind of like therapy do you provide? So
I know a lot of therapy things. There are different types of therapies also. There is mindfulness therapy, there is CBT, there is REBT. So ranging from that, it ranges from person to person. It is you know, I use an eclectic approach. So some people do not believe in meditation at all. So if you don't believe in it, then it's not going to help, you know. And I don't say that meditation is a substitute for therapy. Therapy is a sort of self-development. Even if you think that you don't have any issues and you're doing okay, but you would still want to know more about yourself, then therapy can help you. You know, therapy is not just for people who are sad or depressed. I take therapy and I feel like it is helping me so much, you know. So therapy is for everyone. And just if you want to know what your triggers are, why is it that you function the way you do, then therapy can help you. In case you need counseling sessions, then you can see my page. It's called Swasti Seeks.
Right. I think therapy is like fitness sessions for your mind.
Exactly. Yes. I mean, we do so much for our body. You know, a lot of people do. Right. And gymming is, you know, so in. And people feel that this is like really important for me. But I feel so is therapy. I mean, imagine who is stronger? An elephant who's scared of rats, or a rat who's not scared of elephants? You know?
And one last question, you have to choose one thing.
Yeah.
There are two different statements. Body follows your mind, or is it your mind follows your body? Which is true?
I think both are true.
Hello, thank you so much. Okay. We'll end this podcast. So this was Uncommon Talks with Swasti. And subscribe to our channel.
Thank you for having me here. Bye.